So, thank you for the introduction. Hello, everyone. Yeah, it's my pleasure to be here today to tell you about our joint research on finding the root causes of why app developers are not updating their third-party dependencies in Android apps and measuring to which extent outdated libraries can be updated without modifying the application code. Third-party libraries have become an indispensable aspect of modern software development. They ease the development process by allowing to reuse existing code, but at the same time, they add security vulnerabilities. They increase the app's attack surface by adding security vulnerabilities. This problem is amplified by the fact of application developers using outdated library versions. Thus, even short response times of library developers remain non-effective if security patches are not adopted by application developers. If you have a look on Android, there's further the imminent risk of misuse by such libraries as they inherit their host app's permissions. So how do we approach these problems? Essentially, we need to be capable of detecting third-party libraries in the application binaries. At CCS last year, we presented a novel approach, LibScout, that basically works with open and closed source libraries. And its unique selling point was that it is resilient against commonly used code obfuscation techniques. And it is not only capable of determining the actual library that is used, but also pinpointing exact library versions, which is necessary to determine whether a vulnerable library is used. And then being applied to apps from Google Play, we could measure that over the last years, there was an increasing trend to add more and more third-party code. So nowadays, apps include more than 70%, or the fraction of code that comes from third-party sources is more than 70%. Our results further indicate that more than 70% of all included libraries are severely outdated. And if the app developer takes some action to update the library, it takes, on average, almost 1 year to do so. So while this already gives us some great insights on the current status quo of library outdatedness, we left two important questions unanswered. And that is first, why do app developers not update their third-party dependencies? So what are the root causes? And if we accept that they don't update the libraries, to which extent can we automatically update the library without affecting the application code? So to approach the first problem, we wanted to base our further analysis on some ground truths. Question is, where do we get this information? The answer is simple. We ask app developers directly. So we had a lot of questions. We compiled them into an online questionnaire, and we reached out to app developers from Google Play. Eventually, about 200 very experienced app developers replied, and all of them have worked at least at one or more applications that contained outdated libraries. The 28 questions of our questionnaire can be roughly grouped into three categories. So first, we ask questions about the common workflow, so where do you search for libraries, how do you integrate libraries. We then ask about the motivation and frequency of both application and library updates. And then finally, we ask specifically, if your app contains outdated libraries, why would it? So the first essential question is, where do you search for libraries? The surprising result is that 85% of all application developers just said the internet. So they refer to a search engine. And that's surprising because actually all other major software ecosystems typically have a dependency manager or a library store where you can conveniently search for and compare different libraries. A smaller fraction of application developers also checks for open source libraries on GitHub, and they even consult Stack Overflow in this question. And then being asked about the criteria to choose a specific library or to choose a library over another library, they said that functionality is the main criteria. If it's open source, it's even better, and they also like to have a good documentation, sample code, and so on. So this list continues with five more criteria, until we finally reach the end of the list with, I guess you know what's coming, security. This doesn't mean that they don't care about security at all. It just means that in this initial selection process, security is not a major criterion. When we then ask about the motivation to update an application, the majority said new functionality and bug fixing are the main reasons. And that makes perfectly sense because end users typically always want to have fresh content and they want to see that their app is properly maintained. And only about 1/3 of the application developers explicitly stated library updates as a reason to update the application. And then being asked about the reasons to update the app's libraries, almost all application developers said bug fixing is a reason. Because typically, if you have a bug in the library and it renders the library unfunctional, they have to handle this quickly. And here you can see as well that security fixing and new functionality are only minor reasons to update the application's libraries. And then being asked about the reasons why the app contains outdated libraries, the main reason was that the library was still working. So basically, there was a lack of motivation, or you can also say, never change a running system. The second reason is a bit more interesting, is to prevent incompatibilities. When you ask more concretely, some app developers told us that they at one point tried to update a library, so they replaced the old version with the new version, but then all of a sudden their code editor went crazy, warnings popped up everywhere, and it was flashing red. So they just thought that it takes a lot of effort to fix this, and ultimately they abstained from further updating the library. The third reason is that they were just unaware of updates. So imagine you have a project with 10 to 20 dependencies, all of them originating from different sources, and you have to regularly check each and every source if there is a new library version. This also seems to be too much effort, and therefore app developers don't do this. So now in the following, I want to focus on the highlighted two answers. Because we want to find out if it was just bad coincidence that they took a library version that was, or that took a lot of effort to update to, or if this is a general problem. So is the expectation of a high integration effort actually reasonable? To do so, we first have to distinguish between expected and actual update effort. Where expected means what does the application developer think what it takes to update to a new library version? And in particular, which information drives these expectations? The actual update effort is then based on static analysis to find out which parts of the library has changed and are these changes actually being used by applications. Let's first check the expected update effort. So what is the information provided by the library provider that can be used to infer the expected update effort? One of the most obvious pieces of information are change logs. But our survey results indicate that they are not that they are only read sporadically or not at all. Even worse are update guides. Either they are missing in the first place, or when they are there, then they are even read less by application developers. So the question remains, what is a good piece of information that is, in the best case, always there and can be reliably used by end users, by application developers, to infer compatibility? And the simple answer is, it's the library version string. And I'll give you an example for this. Imagine you have a project with a library in version 1.1. So now, without telling you how this version was specified, if there's a new version 1.2, you would probably agree that this is compatible, because it looks like a tiny change. If now another version comes out, 1.3, you could say, yeah, maybe this still works. But as soon as you have a major version, 2.0, you would say, OK, this does not look as it would be compatible. But you heard it was a lot of maybes, probably yes, probably no. So how must a library developer specify a new version such that the library consumer can reliably infer compatibility? And here with compatibility, I mean a stable public API interface. And a concept to do this is called semantic versioning. It's basically a three-number versioning scheme where each of these numbers has a specific semantic meaning. So you have a major version, a minor version, a patch version. And there's a set of rules that dictate when you have to increment which version. So you have to increment the patch version whenever you have code-only changes. So you refactor the code without affecting the API at all. you increment the minor version if there are backwards compatible changes. So code refactoring and maybe an addition of new functionality. And whenever you break existing APIs, so you remove code, you modify existing APIs, you increment a major version. And intuitively, patch and minor versions are compatible, while if you have a major version, it actually depends on whether the parts that have been modified are actually in use. So how do we infer the expected update effort? We can simply integrate a version parser that actually takes the version string and classifies them into major, minor, and patch version. More interesting is the actual update effort. So basically, we want to know if the library developer adheres to semantic versioning. Or put it differently, does the version string actually reflect the underlying code changes? To do so, we basically have to check the compatibility between public interfaces of adjacent library versions. The problem is that typically you don't have a specification at all. And other than this, you have an API documentation, which tend to be incomplete, and often they're even missing for older versions of the library. Thus, we have to resort to programmatically determine the public library interface. And here the main obstacle is that the public library interface is typically not the same as the set of all public API methods. So we have to do a conservative approximation. To do so, we can leverage the fact that a lot of library providers label sub-packages of their code with internal to indicate that this code is not supposed to be used by the application developer. And we can just filter this out. To account for identifier renaming obfuscation, we can further eliminate public classes that follow those renaming rules. And finally, we conduct a class hierarchy analysis to check for compatible argument types. So if you have an API in the current version, which takes, for instance, an array list, and the new version, the same API takes its supertype, a list, those APIs do not match exactly, but they are compatible. And we can leverage this fact to filter out false positives. When we then apply our analysis to the 89 libraries which we have in our database with more than 10 consecutive versions, and we check the expected update effort, we see an almost picture-perfect software development lifecycle. So the majority of releases are patch versions. We have a smaller number of minor versions and a very small number of API-breaking major changes. But if we now add the result of our code analysis, we can see a completely different picture. So now the vast majority of library releases are API-breaking major changes. And if we look at the misclassification by type, we can see that in 40% of all cases, the application developer expects a compatible version, so a patch or minor version, but he actually gets an API-breaking major version. And that reinforces the fear of experiencing incompatibilities. But so far, we have only talked about libraries in general. So in particular, we are interested in security fixes. For this, we analyzed 8 long-known security vulnerabilities. Among those, we have popular libraries like Facebook, Dropbox. And I can also see the Apache Commons Collection and OKHttp, which even backported a security fix. If you then look at the expected and the actual update effort, you can first see that for the expected update effort, a lot of library providers actually provided a fix as a minor version. So they basically took the code changes and they even added new functionality, which is bad practice in the first place. But even worse is the actual update effort. Here, more than half of the libraries include API-breaking major changes, which severely prevents a widespread adoption of that fix. But then look on how they communicate those security issues. You can see that the picture is pretty frustrating. So you see some of the libraries don't even mention a security problem at all, while others just talk about a bug fix, but this can be pretty much everything. And only the Apache library actually names it a security problem. Only 2 of those issues have a CVE entry, and only half of them are actually known by Google's Application Security Improvement Program. That's surprising because actually we reported everything a couple of months ago. So now we know that library developers do not adhere to semantic versioning, in particular, also not for security patches. But now the interesting question is, can we still upgrade to the fixed version? So we know that patch and minor versions are updatable by definition, but what about the major versions? To analyze this, we conduct a library updatability study. For this, you basically need two pieces of information. The first one is an API stability information. So we basically extract the public library interface as we've done before. But now we do this for all versions of a specific library. We can then generate a mapping of public APIs to versions which support this API. Second, we need the API usage in the application. For this, we can leverage the fact that LibScout already provides a mapping of original to identified root package. So for instance, if the original library has a root package called Facebook, but in the app it was obfuscated to comfb, you can scan the rest of the bytecode to calls into the namespace comfb. And this way, we can actually determine which APIs are in use. If you don't find any call, this typically implies that the library is dead code. So for instance, the application developer refactored the code but forgot to delete the dependency. And then finally, we just have to check what is the maximum version that supports all of the actively used APIs. In this scenario, we could automatically upgrade the library to a version 3.23.1 without affecting the application code at all. We then applied our updatability study on apps of Google Play. So we scanned more than 1 million apps, found more than 2 million instances of libraries. And if we check the updatability by library, you can see that JSON has, Google's JSON utility library, has an almost perfect updatability even to the latest version which is existing. And this is basically because of they have a pretty solid API design which rarely changes over time. On the other hand, we have 8 libraries with at most 20% updatability to the current version, and that is because the frequently used APIs are changing pretty often. We now plot our results. We have the 2 million instances of the library matches. We further subclassify them into actively used and not used. We see that about a 12% share is actively dead code. To further subclassify, we can see that about 1.5 million instances can be upgraded by at least one version. And finally, we can see that over 50% of those libraries can even be upgraded to the latest version. Now getting back to our security problems. Here, there are the 8 libraries with a known security vulnerability. The colors indicate whether we can actually automatically upgrade the vulnerable version to a fixed version, which is light green, to the maximum version and dark green, or not at all, which is indicated by red. In total, we found about 20,000 instances of vulnerable versions, out of which we can automatically patch 97.8%. It looks a bit different here because I scaled those bars to 100%, but the total numbers differ for each library. If I now annotate the libraries with the actual update effort, we can infer some interesting insights. For instance, the AirPush library on top has a perfect updatability even to the latest version. And that is due to 2 reasons. First, the fixed version is the latest version, and it's also a patch version. And we were only able to retrieve 1 vulnerable version prior to that. And by definition, we can update to the latest version. Then you can also see for the Apache and the OKHTTP library that they both have an almost perfect fixing rate. And that is mainly due to the fact that they provided a backport patch for the security issue. Now, an interesting case is the Dropbox library, where about 1/3 of the instances cannot be upgraded. And that's surprising because actually, upon vulnerability notification, Dropbox reacted very quickly. So within a day, they provided a security fix, and it was also a patch-only fix. But the problem was that the 3 vulnerable versions before this, one of them actually included some API breaking changes. So the vulnerable versions before that version could not be upgraded beyond that version. So in this case, another backport of the security patch would have given better results. Okay, so far we have talked a lot about root causes and what we can do if we actually remove the developer from fixing issues. But what are the actual short and long-term solutions for the Android ecosystem? Because I would argue that just pointing your fingers at the application developer saying, okay, here's an issue, just update your dependencies and we don't have a problem anymore, is just too naive, because it's a very complex problem which requires a combined effort of different actors of the Android ecosystem, starting with the library developer, who should actually follow semantic versioning rules to provide a simple means of assessing compatibility. Further, they should provide less major versions and also provide backports of security patches, at least for one major version. And they should also improve on communicating security issues, because even if you try to actively find such issues, it's pretty hard. Now, if you remember this graph from the very beginning, we didn't talk about the first and the third reason. They both refer to a lack of development tools. So we already heard it on some sessions yesterday. Here, I just want to highlight 2 points. So first is the lack of the package manager. Other software ecosystems have such a package manager, for instance, Cocoa Pods, Swift Package Manager for iOS, you have NPM for JavaScript, Cargo for Rust, and so on and so forth. And actually, such a package manager for Android would also improve the situation. And we need better development tools. For instance, we could extend the Android Studio IDE, integrating our library updatability study to give application developers simple means to assess compatibility, and if a new version is not compatible, to give them pointers which parts of their code need to be updated. You've seen that we actually can automatically patch a lot of vulnerabilities. We can discuss whether we need an improved platform support. For instance, we could automatically hot patch such vulnerabilities via the on-device compilation that was introduced in Android 6. You can also ask whether dynamic library linking would make sense, but actually, we would first have to evaluate which extent this would help. Finally, also the market operators with Google Play as a market leader need to improve. For instance, they should adopt state-of-the-art approaches to detect vulnerable library versions. And also, their ASI program should show more rigor in removing vulnerable apps after the remediation phase, when application developers actually did not react to their notification. To conclude, we've seen that library developers are a contributing factor to the problem of library outdatedness, and that they often mix security and bug fixes with API breaking changes. They also often misclassify version changes, but we can show that despite this fact, we can automatically upgrade the vast majority of libraries, even to the latest version. And in particular, 97.8% of all vulnerabilities could automatically be hot patched. And finally, I've shown you that this is a very complex problem involving different actors of the Android ecosystem. And it really takes some combined effort to improve on this situation in a more substantial way. And with that, thank you for your attention.
Sebastian Lekis, Google. I have a question to your definition of upgradability. So it seems that you define upgradability as the possibility to upgrade an app without having breaking changes to the API. But in practice, many breaking changes are not occurring in the API itself, but could be connected to behavior. So I was wondering if you looked into breaking changes in the behavior of the API as well.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So actually, we did not, that's the short answer. The long answer is, for this you need to have a proper specification of what is the intended functionality, intended semantic of the library, which is pretty hard to generalize. On the other side, if there's also bad behavior of the library developer if you change the semantics without changing the API. Because then actually the end user, the consumer, the application developer also has a problem that something changed in terms of functionality without noticing that. Yeah, so basically it pretends to be compatible, but actually some semantic change.
Yeah, but that's often the case in practice. I know a couple of cases where things like that happen, and I was wondering whether you could maybe use unit tests to do that. Like, for example, you have several different versions, and you know you have unit tests for the newest version because it's maybe open source. Then you could try to apply the unit test of the newest version of the API to the unit test of the old API and see whether unit tests still run, right? Because the unit test should cover all the different behaviors. And if you have breaking tests, then there might be a change in behavior that you could measure automatically.
Sounds like an interesting approach. Like I said, to generalize it's a bit problematic because, I mean, still you need to know what is the supposed behavior. And it might work for some libraries better than for others. For instance, utility libraries are better than, for instance, autonomously working advertisement libraries. But it's a great idea.
Hi, Sarah Elder, NCSU. You mentioned that you had 89 libraries with almost 2,000 different versions. Did you take any look at the distribution of the different versions? So did you have a few libraries with a lot of versions, and most libraries had a few versions? Some libraries, you know, may have had a lot of little versions versus big versions. Did you take a look at any of that?
Yeah, so those that we used for our updatability study had more than 10 consecutive versions, like I mentioned it before. Some of them even have 80, 90 versions. And for those that we were only able to collect a small set, we excluded them from our updatability study. So for these open source libraries, it's pretty easy to get the entire history of the library versions. While for others like advertisement or tracking libraries, it's pretty hard to get all those versions because typically only the most current version is provided. You also have to register with the library provider. You have to create an account. And there it's pretty hard to get the entire history.
But you didn't have a lot of libraries that had hundreds of versions. There were just a few.
No.
Thank you.